Hello, Stagecoach families. It's Christy, your principal here. I can't believe our fall term is already over. To our Stagecoach students, you guys worked so hard this term. It was great to watch you come in every single week, show up focused and engaged, learning, singing, dancing, acting. It was absolutely incredible to be a part of your progress as we worked through some great skills this term. To my Stagecoach families, parents, guardians, thank you so much for continuing to support your children's performing arts education. It's always important, but it has never been more important than now. What they've learned, their resilience, their courage, how we've watched them exercise that creative muscle this term, it has been amazing. To be face-to-face in venue is incredible. For them to be able to be creative, to support one another and learn from one another has been a blessing. I know how lucky we are here in Atlantic Canada to be able to have performing arts education programs here in person this fall, and we're looking forward to being able to do it again in January. Of course, our students worked really hard on their performance arts pieces. We were hoping to be able to have you into the venue to be able to see them in person. However, we were able to capture some of it on video, and we're really thrilled to be able to share that with you now. Again, to my students, congratulations on a great term. Next term in January, we've got some incredible things planned. It is a skills term for us, and we are going to introduce you to even more incredible drama, great performing arts, incredible musicians as well, and then we'll move into our show term in the spring. So can't wait to see you all again. In the meantime, I'm going to leave you with these videos. I hope that you enjoy them. And more importantly, I hope that you have a safe and happy holiday season. Thank you so much for your support of Stagecoach, the performing arts, and of course, on behalf of the entire teaching team, happy holidays.
Hello, Stage 3s. I am so proud of how hard you worked in this very weird musical term and how safe you were staying in your proper distance, listening to the guidelines and the rules so carefully so we could all feel safe and secure making music together. We started with rap at the very beginning so that we could get used to rhythm, being confident in front of each other, and remembering that music comes in all sorts of ways. But we were luckily able to move forward very quickly to some very fundamental, but also quite complicated things about singing and making music together. Because as a group you sang a cappella this term, there were certain things you were really able to work on that are quite advanced and that you really took in stride and really impressed me with for your final performance. We worked a lot on dynamics. What does it mean to sing staccato, sing legato, piano or forte, and how to do that all together as a group so that your voice isn't the only one singing loud or soft, but that it's part of the team creating to that greater sound. You did such a good job projecting, using your breath healthily, warming your voices up in a safe way before you sing so you have longevity to your voice, and also enunciating and using very clear diction, especially with those masks on when you're singing. I'm so proud that you listened to each other and really learned how to create that group sound so much so that we could add things like multi-part harmonies and counter melodies and created something really lovely while you all followed each other and followed a conductor to a final piece. I'm so impressed with what you were able to do. It was great. Moving forward, we're going to expand on what we got to touch on a little bit this term with auditions and singing solos. We're going to work a little bit more on stylistic singing. What does it mean if you're singing in harmony in a barbershop quartet versus if you're singing in harmony in a pop rock style, or to be a backup singer versus a forward singer? What does it mean to slate an audition? We touched on this a little bit, but to really dive in even further and have more one-on-one time working on specific technique, getting our confidence up and ready to walk into that room or make that self-tape with confidence that's going to get us into the room and get us those parts that we want and really start to make us feel more confident as individual musical theater practitioners. I'm so proud of you and I'm really looking forward to diving in deeper next term.
Have you seen the ghost of John? Long white bones. Hello, Stage 3s and everyone else watching at home. I hope you're having a wonderful, wonderful time in the snow and the cold and all the other wonderful things that winter has to offer. Maybe you're excited that school's going to be over soon, get a little bit of a break. I am so, so excited about everything we did this past term at Stagecoach. It has been a monumental Stagecoach semester. We've learned so, so much, going all the way back to learning some of the fundamentals of acting on stage and doing drama. We looked at blocking, we looked at characterization, physicalization, qualities of voice, we looked at pharyngeal resonance, oral resonance, and nasal resonance, and how we can use those to inform character. We explored with improv, we explored with creating scenes, creating stories, creating environments, putting that all together. We also worked on development of a plot, of a script, of an idea. I was so excited to get all of your input to help create our script, The Forerunner. And I was so, so excited to write it for all of you. It was my pleasure to get to write an original show for such an exceptional group of young performers. I am so sad we didn't get to perform it in person, but I am so, so pleased to get to share our spontaneous Zoom table read of the script with everyone at home. You've done a fantastic job. I can't wait to see what you do next, and I hope to see you next term at Stagecoach. We're going to explore even further into the wonderful world of drama. Now, I know that movie theaters are closed for the most part, and I'm going to try and give you as much of a movie-like experience going into this reading performance as possible. So without further ado, presenting The Forerunner, presented by Stagecoach's very own Stage 3s.
Have you ever heard a really good ghost story?
Something more than the traditional spooky white sheet ghost story.
Have you ever heard a true ghost story?
Something more than the stories of stormy nights or branches scraping against windows.
Have you ever seen something that chilled you to the core, but you didn't know why? Have you ever seen a shadow in the corner of your eye or a crow circling ominously overhead?
Have you ever had a feeling deep down inside of you in a dark place that you never want to visit, that something bad was about to happen?
Bad dream that comes true the day.
Have you ever seen something that you couldn't explain that haunts you each and every time you think of it?
Have you ever witnessed a forerunner, a spirit of the living forerunning, the arrival of misfortune and death?
You're about to.
All of the spirits of the villagers disappear. Chapter 1, The Frozen Ground.
One fine frosty morning in February, in the early 1900s, a truck filled with wooden boards drove up to an old farmhouse in Antigonish, Nova Scotia. The two men on it began to unload it, letting the boards slap down one after the other onto the frozen ground.
A cold one this morning, eh, James?
I'll say, it's a shame about Mr. Gravestead. By the sound of it, he was lying sick in bed since November.
When the truck was unloaded, they went into the house. The lady who lived there was the daughter of the deceased.
I hope you're going to finish your job this time. Many a cold night all winter you worked out there. Night after night, I lay awake listening to that truck driving up to the door and those boards being thrown off. Then the sawing and the hammering would begin, so that I was terrified to death, for I thought one of the family was going to die.
You've been hearing that too, Tabitha? I thought I was losing my mind. I didn't want to say anything at risk of startling the family.
Tabitha, Henry, we've never been here before.
From that day forward, once Tabitha's father was carried out in the coffin and laid to rest, the noises were never heard again.
Chapter 2, The Shadow of the Canso.
Mm.
Main highway in Port Hawkesbury, Cape Breton skirts the cliffs that rise high above the waters of the Strait of Canso, once close to the tracks of the Canadian National Railway.
Across the narrow ribbon of water, Cape Porcupine casts its dark shadow from the Mulgrave side of the street, and the busy ferry boats hastening to bridge the mild wind passage. But there was a time when the houses on the steep hill above the road looked down on a much less active scene.
In these early years, two old women were walking along this highway.
The two old women, Bertha and Florence, enter the scene, chatting.
So then I told him, if you want me to go on a ride in your boat, you'd best be prepared to have me flopping around the floor with the fish.
Oh, Bertha, you're wicked. If handsome Jack Calhoun asked me aboard his boat, I wouldn't think twice. Oh, how long is it then? 12 feet?
They both laugh. Suddenly, they hear a terrible noise. It is a phantom train.
House entered pale, breathless, scared to death.
Frightened you two. You look like a couple of ghosts.
Oh, Lord, help us. There was this terrible noise. A rushing and a clattering. Oh, huge thing. It's one glowing.
It came rattling past us and went right through the fish house that was nearby.
Nobody believed what they had seen. Years later, Florence heard a real train for the first time on the mainland of Nova Scotia and recognized the sound as the one she had previously heard on that night. Both ladies died before the Inverness Railway was actually ever built. The track, when surveyed, passed through where the old fish house once stood. Chapter 3, The Bird.
The appearance of unusual birds, the crowing of roosters at unusual times, were usually looked on as omens of death and misfortune.
Once, many, many years ago in Mabu, two young girls were out swimming when they saw a big bird come in from the sea and land on the shore.
We see Lizzie and Lucy enter, splashing around and playing as children do. This is shortly followed by the arrival of a strange bird.
Lucy, Lucy, I want to play a new game. How about pirates? I'll be the ghastly Blackbeard, and you can be my first mate, Barrelbottom Jones.
Why do my characters always have such silly names, Lizzie? Maybe I want to pick the next game.
I'm the oldest, so I get to choose. Well, maybe we could play mermaids.
Yay, I love mermaids. Look how long I can hold my breath.
Lucy. Lucy, come up. Lucy, this isn't part of the game. Lucy, there's an awfully strange bird looking here. You should see. Lucy?
Boo!
That wasn't funny. Between you and the bird, you're going to give me a heart attack.
Whoa, look how calm she is. Maybe I could catch her.
No, don't. It's a Tabith.
What's that?
It's a spirit. It means we're going to get some bad news. Come on, we need to get home.
They went home as quickly as possible and reached there just before dark. To their surprise, the roosters were crowing ominously as they passed the barns.
The next day, news arrived of their uncle, a sailor, who just the night before had drowned at sea.
Chapter 4, The Watch. In pioneer days, whenever anyone died in a house, the friends and relatives kept close watch lest a little white animal resembling a weasel might get into the house without their knowledge. The little animal was the warning of the Aug, a spirited evil attendant at Wakes, and it let them know it had come into the house. If it came, they would take a large knife or some other piece of steel and pass it through the flour and meal and all the food that was in the pantry.
Caution was neglected. These materials would then become useless, and so this watch was always kept, including on one rainy autumn night in Chester, where poor friends experienced something truly horrifying.
James, Lenore, Sam, and Hannah enter. They all seem in good enough spirits, but with a level of gravity to their situation. They sit in a semicircle on the floor around a dead body covered with a white sheet.
You all remember that time that Mr. Smith let us take turns riding on the horse when we were younger? I could have ridden through that field 1,000 times.
Was that the horse that you fell off of and cried in the corner of the barn the rest of the day?
He was a good man. I'm going to miss his bushy beard freezing in the winter.
Oh, and his pumpkin pie. Remember when he brought some to class? That was delicious. Mm. Hannah, you've been quite quiet. Are you all right?
Yeah, sorry. It's just so late, and I keep hearing strange sounds outside. I'm trying to keep an eye out for the weasel. Mr. Smith would be disappointed if we let that creature in. And his wife is sleeping, so we shouldn't be too noisy.
We're all here for the same reason. Doesn't mean we can't reminisce. Besides, I'm keeping an eye out for y'all.
As the night wore on and the fire dimmed, the forest students found they were having a hard time staying awake. Suddenly, the flicker of the flames and the shadows on the walls began to cast curious shadows. All fell asleep, except for Hannah, who clutched a small dagger in her hand.
Of course they've fallen asleep. They're probably right. There are no wicked spirits out here. It's just a safe old farmhouse. The forests outside are the same trees that are there during the day. There's nothing to be frightened of.
All at once, there was an angry wind that blew open the small wooden door and extinguished the flame.
Who's there? Anna, did you open the door?
Somebody closed it, the rain's getting in.
The weasel, I just seen him run in. I seen a slimy white body slip through the door in the moonlight. I'm going to kill it.
How could you see that? It's so dark in here. Let's just relight the fire.
Show yourself. Sam, look, it's crawling up your neck.
And I just...
I suppose the weasel, whether real or in our minds, is a sign of bad things to come after all.
Chapter 5, The First Date.
Back in the day, the appearance of mysterious lights was looked upon as a warning of bad things to come. A bad harvest, a bad nightmare, or just bad luck.
One of these lights was seen the night after a long time at the entrance to Antigish Harbor. One of these folks who saw it was a young lady by the name of Dorothy.
It was by the very harbor where Dorothy had planned to meet with a local stable worker, Jamie, for an entire evening of romance. Needless to say, not all forerunners are warnings of death and destruction.
So, Jamie, how was the stable today? Was that mule still being mean to you?
You mean that old rickety donkey? Yes, he is. But how about you? How was your day?
churning more butter, knitting more little mittens for the orphanage.
Oh, you make it sound so unremarkable. I'll have you know that I spent my day on Main Street picking out a new plum for my lips and some new dresses.
I'm looking forward to seeing them.
Jamie leans in to kiss Dorothy, but stumbles and hits their face.
Oh my god. Oh, sorry. Are you all right? I'd really meant to kiss you, but I must have pulled back and had you fall right over.
I'm all right, I think. I might have chipped the tooth. It's all right. I'm sure you can help me.
Oh, yes, of course. Here, have some cotton in my pocket. You can use it to wipe the blood off your lip.
As Jamie starts wiping, they feel a huge spider crawl off and into their mouth.
Oh, shit. Oh,
oh, my goodness. Oh, no. That was the cloth I used to dust out the attic today. I must have picked up a spider on it. Here, I'm so sorry.
No harm done, I suppose. Now, where were we?
Oh, yes. I'm so frightened to kiss you, though. I saw some strange lights in the sky yesterday evening, and I'm scared they've cursed me to ruin our relationship, Jamie.
Let's sit down, all right? Now, there's no way I can slip and fall. I will wash out the blood and spiders with my own water. See, there's nothing to stop us now.
She blushes, they lean in and kiss.
All right, I suppose that wasn't too dangerous.
Maybe just one more to be sure.
Jamie leans in, but suddenly stops.
I can't breathe. What did you do to me?
It was nothing. It was just my lips and maybe the new balm I got, but that's just beeswax. And
I'm allergic. Oh.
Doctor. A forerunner can predict the ending of your life. Or the very bad ending of the first date.
The other ghostly villagers slowly float in, laughing.
Good one.
Have you ever heard a really good ghost story?
Have you ever heard a true ghost story?
If you did, could you even believe it?
Would you believe your own eyes or ears if you witnessed a forerunner?
Do you tell yourself that the things that go bump in the night are harmless?
When it is only your mind playing tricks on you? You ever have a feeling deep down inside of you in a dark place you never want to visit, that there is something there?
The shadow on your wall seems to have red, glowing eyes.
Or the calm, peaceful night you spend lying in your bed is filled with unexplainable sounds.
Have you ever witnessed a forerunner? A spirit of the living forewarning the arrival of misfortune and death?
You have now.
Bravo! Very, very good job, everybody. Congratulations, that was fantastic.
Hi, awesome. My name is May, and I'm the dance teacher here at Stagecoach. This semester, we focused on learning a complex choreography that explored characterization and quality through dance movements. With having to wear masks, the students quickly learned how to portray emotions through their bodies and through their movements so that the audience is still able to understand the intention behind the dance. Next semester, we will focus on breaking down our basic movements and really focusing on the dancer's technique and foundation of dance. This will include focusing on movements such as pirouettes, pas de bourrée, jetés, and center work so that the dancer has greater confidence in their ability to dance and these complex movements. I really hope you enjoy their performance.